Okay, so let us try. So if we want to set up a cloud environment within our own infrastructure, we may assume that we are going to build a cloud environment in a lab. So we have multiple machines, and using those systems we have to create a cloud environment. So how it can be built? So we can use different tools. One very popular tool is Eucalyptus. Okay, so this is the name of this tool is Eucalyptus. Okay, we have discussed earlier the full form of Eucalyptus. So by this name we can understand. So E stands for elastic, U stands for U stands for utility, okay, elastic utility, then I'm writing it here, computing architecture, linking your programs this one is your programs to useful systems. So this is the full form of Eucalyptus. So by this name you can understand what is the purpose of cloud computing. So it provides elastic resource allocation, it's a utility based computing environment. Okay, so how much you will consume based on that it will be built. So it's a utility computing architecture linking your programs to useful systems. So when we are running some program in our own infrastructure, it can be as my machine. Now some part of this program can be deployed in a cloud environment which will be executed there and I will get the result. Okay, so your system is being connected to some useful systems where you can offload your job. So this is the purpose of cloud environment. Some part of the job can be executed in your local machine and rest of the part can be executed in some other environment. Obviously this type of services will be provided by cloud environment. Now based on your requirement we may get different types of cloud services. So you will choose the services according to your demand. Now how this cloud environment is being set up? So if we consider that, so this is the representation of internet. So from internet there will be a connection in our network. So within our infrastructure how it can be managed? So in if we consider it logical representation, then there will be a cloud controller. So it's known as CLC. It's basically cloud controller. Along with this CLC, now this CLCs will be connected with multiple cluster controllers. This CLCs will be connected with cluster controllers. So if we say that this one is cluster controller 1, there can be another cluster controller, so it's cluster controller 2. In that way we may have n number of cluster controller. Okay, so these are basically cluster controller. These are cluster controller. Now in every cluster controller there will be some node. So these nodes are nothing but the server. So these machines are known as node controller or NC. So in every CLC cluster controller, there will be multiple machines. Okay. In every cluster controller, there will be multiple machines. So these are known as NC, or they are node controllers. So in this node controller, actually the computation will be performed. Okay. In cluster environment, if we consider cluster environment, there are two types of cluster. One is storage cluster and another one is compute cluster. Okay, so generally we can categorize, when we don't have grid computing or cloud computing, at that time we have generally technologies use different types of cluster for their purpose. So if we consider these clusters, so these clusters can be classified as, one is type of cluster is storage cluster, and another type of cluster is compute cluster. Okay, compute cluster. But in cloud environment, each and every cluster has the capability of storage as well as capability for computation. Okay, otherwise this environment cannot be set up. So each and every cluster must have the capability for storing some data and performing high computing tasks. So huge resources are available, CPU and memory resources, so that it can be managed. So this is the logical representation. So an internet connection is being, if we use any internet connection like broadband or anything else, then by this internet connection we are connecting this CLC. So every user from other end, like if I consider this is an user, now this user will be able to connect to this cloud environment using CLC. They will not get access to CC or NC directly. Every request must be routed through CLC. So when this CLC will receive a request from a user, so multiple users are there. So when a CLC will receive a request from a user, then CLC will decide in which cluster environment we have to deploy this task. Okay, as we are talking about, at this moment we are talking about Eucalyptus, which is infrastructure as a service. Okay, it's infrastructure as a service. So if it's infrastructure as a service, we can get virtual machines from this environment. Okay, so we can deploy a virtual machine. So a virtual machine is basically, it can, a virtual machine can be built based on some, you can specify that how many CPU resources are needed, so how many CPU cores will be allocated for this VM, how much main memory will be allocated. Okay, along with that you can specify that how much network IO is required. So if you submit this information during your VM deployment request, then CLC will receive this data. After getting this data, now CLC will decide in which cluster it will deploy the virtual machine. The cluster will not be taken from you, the cluster information, that you can't mention that I want to deploy this virtual machine in this cluster. No, that's not possible. Okay, so you can submit your information, CLC will decide that in which cluster it is to be deployed. So when it is being deployed in a cluster, then this cluster controller will decide that many node controllers are registered with this cluster, so in which cluster, which node controller it will deploy this virtual machine. So if I think that when we are getting this request, so from this user 1, if I get this request at CLC, if CLC decides that this VM needs to be deployed in cluster 2, it will go to cluster 2, then cluster controller will decide that this VM needs to be deployed in a specific node controller. So if it decides that it will deploy this virtual machine in this node controller, then this virtual machine will be instantiated here. Okay, so in that way cloud environment works. Okay, now if we think this logical representation, so what will be the network structure, how it can be managed? So network structure means we have physical connectivity among the servers. So one server is basically this one. So if we think of a server, so this is a server. So one node controller is basically, it's also known as host, or it's actually in physical, as a physical machine, it's a server. Okay, so this machine can be a rack server. Okay, so in that way they are being deployed. Now few things we have to understand here, that when we are going to deploy a virtual machine, how it will be deployed. So we need some images, because when you are specifying this resource requirement, along with this you have to mention that I want to deploy a virtual machine using RHEL 7.0. Okay. So if you say that you need a virtual machine having Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7.0, so this is the operating system which needs to be installed in that virtual machine. So basically a virtual machine will be instantiated based on an image of RHEL 7.0 having the resources like you have mentioned, 2 CPU cores, 4 GB memory, and say it's 10 Mbps network connectivity. So if you have mentioned this, then the virtual machine will be deployed in this cloud environment. So how it will be managed? So this machine image, so when you are installing an operating system on your laptop or desktop, what do you do? So basically you collect an ISO image, you collect an ISO. So this ISO is basically, say you want to install RHEL 7.0, so you will collect an ISO, you will create a bootable disk, then you can install it. Okay, in cloud environment the things are similar. Okay, so you have to download an operating system image. In cloud environment the things are similar, you have to download an operating system image. So this RHEL 7.0, Red Hat or CentOS, Windows, whatever operating system we are choosing, these operating systems are basically OS images. Okay, so these are operating system images. In cloud environment we say that these things are machine image. Okay, we say that these things are machine image. So when we want to deploy a virtual machine, we have to choose a machine image. So how it can be chosen? So these images must be loaded in cloud environment. So there will be another module along with this CLC. So this one is known as Walrus. This one is Walrus. So where machine images will be stored. Okay, so if you want to create your own machine image as a cloud service provider, or if you want to use it for your own purpose, whatever it is, you can install this, you can install or load these images in Walrus. Okay, so the machine images are being loaded in Walrus. So when a user specifies, so many machine images will be there. Just at this moment, if I think that I have one RHEL 7.0, I have another operating system image, say it's a CentOS 5.0, I have Ubuntu 15.10, like this. So I have this machine images. So how it can be loaded? So first of all, as a service provider, you have to create some images and you have to register those images so that they are loaded in Walrus. Okay, so this machine images will be loaded in Walrus. It's a storage device. Okay, so we can treat a different server where Walrus modules will be installed and this machine will work as Walrus of this cloud environment. So when a user will choose a virtual machine configuration, then based on that user's choice, an operating system image will be loaded in a node controller. In which node controller it will be loaded? That will be determined by CLC, and later on it will be determined by CC. Okay. Now, after deploying a VM, just I am assuming that your virtual machine VM1 is running. VM1 is running in this physical machine. Your another virtual machine VM2 is running in this machine. Some other user is running another VM which is running here. So VM3 is running in this machine. So in that way, the virtual machines can be deployed. So how long the virtual machines can be deployed in a physical machine? That is completely dependent on the resource availability. If we say that for this physical machine, we have 256 core CPU and 128 GB RAM, then how many virtual machines are being deployed and what is their configuration? Based on that, these resources will be used. So once the resources will be overfull, so that new virtual machines cannot be deployed in the same physical machine. Okay, so in that way CLC and CC will take the decision that this new virtual machine request is to be instantiated in which node controller. Okay, any confusion here?
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, when the virtual machine request is made, can it be always the requirements can that be judged at that time, because the later on the requirements may increase if the requirements are allotted. If the cluster is allotted as per the initial requirements, then that might change.
Okay, just then. I'm coming to your point. Just I have to receive a call. Wait for a minute. Hello. চিনতে পেরেছি, বুঝতে পারবো না। হ্যাঁ আছি, বাড়িতে খুব প্রবলেম চলছে, কোভিড রিলেটেড নয় সরাসরি, কিন্তু খুব প্রবলেম চলছে। আচ্ছা, দুটো নয়, মানে বেসিক্যালি একটাই, মানে আপনি পাওয়ার সিস্টেম রাখতে পারেন, মানে ডকুমেন্টে কোথাও পাওয়ার সিস্টেম থাকে, কোথাও এটা পাওয়ার সিস্টেম রাখুন, এমটেক ইন পাওয়ার সিস্টেম। হ্যাঁ আচ্ছা না, হ্যাঁ ওটা পাওয়ার সিস্টেম করবে। আচ্ছা হ্যালো, ইয়া সো
ইয়েস স্যার,
জাস্ট আনাদার মিনিট। হ্যাঁ স্যার বলুন। হ্যাঁ ক্লাসে আছি, বলুন। আচ্ছা আমার তো প্রায় 12টা পর্যন্ত ক্লাস, আমি পড়ে নিয়ে তারপরে দেখছি। আচ্ছা সো হিয়ার, সো ইয়োর কোয়েশ্চেন ইজ অ্যাট দ্য বিগিনিং উই ডোন্ট নো দ্যাট হাউ মাচ রিসোর্সেস আর নিডেড, উই ক্যান চুজ আ ভার্চুয়াল মেশিন কনফিগারেশন দ্যাট অ্যাট দিস মোমেন্ট উই হ্যাভ ডিসাইডেড দ্যাট দিস ভার্চুয়াল মেশিন উইল রিকোয়ার টু সিপিইউ কোর 4 GB র্যাম। ওকে সো লেটার অন ইট ক্যান বি মডিফাইড, সো ইফ উই ডিপ্লয় ইট অ্যাজ এ স্কেলেবল ভিএম হুইচ আর উইল এনেবল অটো স্কেলিং, so automatically the resources, more resources will be allocated or existing resources will be deallocated based on its utilization. Am I clear? Hello?
Yes sir, yes sir.
Okay, so anything else, any other query? Okay, fine. So in that way, the virtual machines are being deployed. So this is the here in Walrus, the machine.
For if a particular virtual machine, can it be deployed in one particular cluster but across two different node controllers?
One virtual machine?
Yes, sir.
No, one virtual machine must run within a node controller.
Okay, sir.
So auto scaling doesn't mean that if we increase the size of the existing VM, it will increase infinitely. It's not like that. So if you enable auto scaling to provide this service, multiple instances of the virtual machine will be launched. Sometimes some resources will be scaled of the existing VM, and most of the time multiple instances of similar virtual machine will be executed or deployed. So there are different types of scaling, we can come to that later. Okay. So one virtual machine must run within a node controller. One virtual machine cannot be deployed by combining the resources of multiple node controller. It's not possible. It will run within a environment, within one node controller only. Now next thing is, when we have deployed this virtual machine, sometimes it requires some data which will be stored outside of the VM. So generally another type of storage is connected with each and every cluster controller. So this is known as storage controller, which is connected with the cluster controller. So with every cluster controller there will be a storage controller. Okay. So they are connected with this. Now try to understand that what are the different ways, like if we have a virtual machine here, then virtual machine is running within this node controller, then whether too large number of virtual machines can be deployed within a node controller. It's not again true. We have a limitation that we can't say that very large number of virtual machines can be deployed in one physical machine, because we are using some virtualization technologies. So virtualization technologies must be installed within the node controller. So here, this node controllers, we have node controllers in lowest layer. So virtualization technology must be installed here. So you have to implement virtualization in node controllers. Virtualization is not needed in cluster controller or cloud controller. So what the actually the virtual machines will be deployed or it will be executed, in those machines only it is needed. Okay, so in those machines virtualization is needed. So for this purpose we can use Gen or KVM. We will discuss it later again. So we can install Gen or KVM so that these systems, these node controllers becomes ready for deploying a virtual machine. So then it will be able to run a virtual machine. Okay, now coming to this point, so what will be the data center, how it will be managed? So in a data center, so we have at the very beginning we have mentioned that this is logical representation. So this is a logical representation, but actually the devices are not connected in that way. Okay, so how they are connected? Generally, if we consider a data center, then within a data center we have multiple switches. So multiple switches at core layer. So these switches are known as core switch. These core switches are connected with multiple, each and every core switch is connected with multiple aggregation switch. It's an aggregation switch. Okay. Similarly, like this, we don't have sufficient space, but we have to manage it in that way. So these switches will be connected with this, similarly it will be again connected with these switches. So we can use multiple redundant link. The reason is very simple, because if one link fails at a time, then within very short time, within fraction of second, it will be able to determine an alternative route. So if we use tree network, then if one link fails, if a link fails, then all the devices of that subtree will be disconnected from internet, they will not be accessible. That's why in a data center we use lots of redundant link. Now this aggregation switches are basically connected with TOR switch. So these are known as top of rack TOR switch. Okay, now using those TOR switch, the rack servers are connected. Okay, so each and every rack will be treated as a node controller. Try to understand that each and every rack will be treated as node controller. Okay, so this TOR switches are connected with aggregation switch. So in that way the connection is been established. So if we have a virtual machine, the virtual machine is being deployed in a rack server. These rack servers are connected to a mesh network which is being formed by some standard topologies, like sometimes we use VL2 or sometimes we use FAT3. So many other topologies are there, but FAT3 is mostly used in building the data center network. So these are the network topologies by which the devices or the servers are connected in a data center. In logical representation, we are discussing that these are the different modules which are to be installed in this server. So we can install CLC module, that is the cluster controller module, in one server. Sorry, CLC is cloud controller. So cloud controller module is in one server. Different cluster controller modules in different servers, and these virtual machines will be deployed in node controllers or hosts. So these hosts will be connected in that way using this FAT3 or VL2 network, where each and every host will be connected to a top of rack switch. So this is the way how we are building a cloud environment. Now generally, it's not standard for every network, but generally we use 1 Gbps connection. Generally we use 1 Gbps connection for this. Okay, so generally in this link we use 1 Gbps connection. It's 1 Gbps, and for core switch we use 10 Gbps connection. And sometimes within the TOR, within this link, sometimes it's 200 Mbps, sometimes it's 512 Mbps. So you can understand that the capacity or capability of data transfer is too high. So when we are going to install a virtual machine like RHEL 7.0, if the image size is, where is the mouse pointer, if we think that this RHEL 7.0, if the image size is 5 GB, so this 5 GB image is loaded in Walrus. From this Walrus, it is to be loaded in a node controller where this VM will be instantiated. So it will take very short time. So for this link, if the connectivity is 256 Mbps, you can easily calculate that how much time is needed to transfer this image from Walrus to this node controller. So this image will be transferred, or it will be copied. I should not use transfer because it will not be removed from Walrus. So it will be transferred, it will be copied in a node controller, and after copying this image, now it will instantiate the virtual machine. Okay. This is how this network works. Any confusion up to this? Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Any confusion in this section, whatever we have discussed till now? Now, let us try to understand that how it will be. Okay, few more things on this area. how this cluster controllers, or what kind of task will be performed by cluster controller? We know that we have discussed that when a new VM deployment request will be received by a cluster controller, it will decide that in which host or node controller it is to be deployed. So if it has to be deployed in some host, how it will be determined? How it will decide that I have to deploy it in that host? So basically, in cluster controller, when you are registering a node controller with a cluster controller, so first of all, I want to mention here, these are software modules. So these are cluster controller or node controller or cloud controller. These are basically software modules. Okay. So if you install this software module in a machine, then this machine will be prepared for running that service. So in a node controller, you have to install node controller module. And if you want to install node controller module, there is a dependency that before installing node controller module, you have to make it ready with virtualization layer. So either you have to install Gen or KVM in that node controller, then you can install node controller software within that machine. Okay. Once it's ready, so node controller will communicate with cluster controller. So each and every node controller must be registered with a cluster controller. So if we have a cluster controller in one machine, node controller in another machine, this node controller must be registered to the cluster controller, so that the cluster controller will get this information that I have a set of node controllers and their hardware resource specification is this. So this amount of resources are available for virtualization. Okay. Now, when it will get a request, in every scheduling clock, cluster controller as well as cloud controller gets the updated information about the current status of node controller or cluster controller. So CLC will collect the information about the current status of CC. CC will prepare this data based on the current information of the NCs. Okay. So in every scheduling clock, they will collect some information that in which node controllers, which virtual machines are running, how much resources are available that can be used for deploying other virtual machines. So all these informations are available to the cluster controllers as well as to the cloud controllers. Now, when a user will submit a request to CLC, it will analyze that data, how much resources are available in which clusters, and if we think of about the energy consumption, optimization of energy consumption, then it will take the decision based on some algorithm that it has to be forwarded, the request has to be forwarded in this cluster. Then the cluster will receive the data, it will analyze the data which it have. Based on the data, it will decide that in which node controller it is to be deployed. So many algorithms are there for aiming different objectives. So those things are not within the scope of this paper. We are going to discuss only the basic concept. So this is how the system works. Okay. Now, so any doubt about the architecture of Eucalyptus?
So is the Walrus also a software module just like the cluster controllers and cloud controllers?
Yeah, it's again a software module.
Okay.
It's a software module. This storage controller is again a software module, but obviously with this software you must have the hardware, otherwise Walrus software is installed in a machine which has only 1 GB storage. We want to store images. It's not possible. So Walrus is a software module which will manage how these images will be stored in that server. So if we install any image, that will be loaded in Walrus. So CLC will directly communicate with Walrus to get an image. Okay. Now let us talk about these are the different components. Now think of a scenario that I am going to use a cloud environment where I will deploy my own image. As we have talked about earlier, like forget about cloud environment. In your lab, like in room number, say it's room number 208. In this lab, you have to install some operating system. We have a requirement that in this lab, in each and every machine, we need MySQL, Eclipse, Java 16. Okay, so we need this software in each and every machine, and obviously we want to deploy it on CentOS 7.0. So in each and every machine of room number or lab number 208, I want to install the machines in that way. What can I do? How will you install these machines? Say I have 50 machines in this lab. We have 50 computers in this lab. What will be your preference, or which policy will take to install these machines with these resources and within very short time?
Try through some centralized technique.
Centralized technique means, can you give me any example?
Sir, a best fit policy approach should be taken.
Best
fit approach should be taken, because otherwise, you know, there might be wastage of resources.
Best fit approach means? What do you want to say? Best fit means what? In every machine, we have to install this softwares, and we have to install CentOS 7.0. So, what we can do? Any other opinion? Okay, let me consider that. I have a laptop. I'm sitting here. This is the cloud environment of Calcutta University. Okay, so it's a CU, say it's a CU cloud. Okay. I'm sitting here. So this is my machine. I will download this image. So first phase is, I will download the operating system image. Okay, so I will download CentOS sorry, CentOS 7.0. Then I will mount this image on my machine. I will mount this image on my machine. Then I will install required softwares. I'll install this required software. So required software means this MySQL, Eclipse, JDK 16, everything will be installed. Then I will unmount the image. So we have done the modification here. We'll unmount the image. Okay. After unmounting it, now the operating system image is ready, where MySQL is installed, Eclipse is installed, as well as JDK 16 is installed. Okay. So now this image contains all these modules. I have to install it in lab. So I will go to lab. In one machine, I will mount this image, and for all other 49 machines, I will just start installation by using network install. So simultaneously, all other machines will be configured with this software resources. So in every machine, it will be CentOS 7.0 having MySQL, Eclipse, and JDK 16. So each and every machine will be ready. So I don't need to install that operating system in every machine manually and install all the software modules one by one. So instead of that, we can prepare an operating system image. Using this operating system image, we can install each and every machine of that lab. Okay, so this is the way how we can do it. Generally, your network administrator installs this software in every lab in every semester, or at the very beginning of the semester, they prepares the lab in that way. In cloud environment, we are going to use the same thing. Say, as a development team, we need CentOS 7.0 having this software. So I want to deploy a virtual machine with this software, with an operating system having this software, and I will mention that how much resources are needed for instantiating the virtual machine. Okay, so at the very beginning, what we can do, if we use our own cloud environment like CU Cloud, what we can do, we can prepare the image. Now this image needs to be registered in cloud environment. So when we are going to register this image in cloud environment, then it will be loaded in Walrus. Now the modified operating system image is loaded in Walrus. If I want to instantiate this image, I want to create a virtual machine based on this image, then you have to specify that this much of resources is needed. Okay, so if you specify the resources, like I need 2 GB RAM, 2-core processor, and 100 Mbps network connectivity, then based on that, it will instantiate a virtual machine in some node controller. Okay. So can you visualize the thing, that where the operating system images are being stored and why the images are stored in Walrus?
Sir, someone has given an alternative in the chat, if you can check it once.
Okay. Yeah, obviously this is the way. So you use network boot. Just before doing this network boot, in some machine during this network boot, you are accessing the base operating system image. Now basically that image can be modified. So you can download the image, you can modify it, you can just mount it in one machine, and using network boot you can, my god,